to be maybe the motivation for it, or in my mind, I'm sure there was a lot more to it than that, but it does go through in much detail the science behind climate change, and it does talk, or Dr. Dibble does talk in it, some thoughts about, number one, what you can do as an individual, and number two, maybe why people don't do that, and that's one of the things that really intrigues me, as we talked about earlier. So with that, I will introduce you to Dr. Brad Dibble.
Thanks very much. Should you applaud until you hear the talk, because maybe you'll regret.
Do you know how to use these cameras?
Well, just it's easy. In fact, turn it on.
Yeah, it's really, that's why I brought that kind of camera.
Okay, so thanks, and thanks for reading the book. It's always nice to hear someone has read it, because it's hard to think you spent 2.5 years of your life and nobody sees the fruits of the labor. But I'm going to start a little bit with the most published photo ever. That's Earth. That's the whole point of why we're here, is to talk about what we can do to try to preserve this. I'm a big astronomy nut too, which actually comes pretty clear in the book, because I start with some astronomical photos, and then I also end with an important one, and I'm going to do that with my talk too. But that was December 11th, 1972, Apollo 17, when they took that photo. I like it so much that I put it on the actual cover of the book, because I just think it's one of the best ways to visualize our planet. And I like to point out that if Earth was a basketball, our atmosphere would just generally be one layer of varnish on top of it. It's a very thin bit of our planet, which is amazing because it's such obviously an important part. We wouldn't be here if it didn't exist. And so when we talk about the issues of climate, and as I walked in, I even heard some of the comments that people hear about it, there are lots of sound bites that everybody can hear every day. Some are on one side of the spectrum, some are on the other, and the problem is only a few of them are accurate. I would say most of them are not, and that's because most people don't really understand the issues with respect to climate crisis, and that's one of the reasons I wanted to tackle this. In fact, it started as a personal project where I wanted to learn for myself what I needed to know. I never intended to learn that with the plan to teach people later on. That just kind of came as a subsequent aspect of it. But I keep a blog, in case, maybe you don't know that, but I keep a blog about this, and it sometimes engages in some interesting conversations, which is good for me, because then I can figure out where I can sort out if things are inaccurate, or maybe I'm mistaken about something. Like, I'm not pig-headed about this. I want to make sure I understand the issues. This was one of the comments that came out. This is actually someone I went to high school with. I won't quote his or her name to avoid embarrassment. But this was the comment that came out. This is one of the most extreme forms of egotism and arrogance that could ever be put on display. That humans think they could actually change the climate of an entire planet. And it was funny because that struck me similar to some other things I've heard, one, that the Earth does not revolve around the Sun, which was Galileo said that in 1633, and to be fair, he didn't even believe it himself. He was under house arrest, and the Catholic Church forced him to make that claim. But there's one, here's another one, Louis Pasteur's theory of germs is ridiculous fiction. As a physician, obviously, I find that one interesting, by a physiologist in France. We don't like their sound, and guitar music is on the way out. This was Decca turning down the Beatles in 1962. And here's another good one. There's no reason anyone would want a computer in their home. And this is by Ken Olson, president of Digital Equipment Corp. I know, I'm sure you've all heard of DEC. My son said, "What's DEC?" And I said, "Oh, they rival Apple and Microsoft and all those things." Obviously, this guy was wrong too. But all of these statements have something in common, in case you hadn't noticed. They're all opinions, but they're disguised as facts, and a lot of people do that. Instead of saying, "I think," or "I believe," or "it's my opinion that," they just spit these comments out as if they're fact. And that's, to be fair, these people aren't stupid when they do that, because they recognize if you say, "This is my opinion, blah, blah, blah," you're diminishing the strength or the impact of your comment. So what a lot of people want to do is they just take that part out, they imply it tacitly, but they just spit it out as a fact. Guitar music's on the way out. Germs are a myth. You know, sun isn't the center of our solar system. All these things, and including my friend's comment from my blog that humans couldn't possibly do this. And U.S. Senator Daniel Patrick Moynihan put it best: "You are entitled to your own opinions, but you're not entitled to your own facts." So that's why I titled this talk, "Five Facts You Need to Know." I took this approach of let me say, as if I was a prosecutor and this was a trial, and I've just got to establish facts that are beyond dispute, that neither side of the argument can dispute. So that's what I'm going to do. So fact number one, and I'm going to apologize by saying, obviously I'm talking to a group who has a vested interest in understanding this issue, and some of what I'm going to say you already understand, and I don't mean to imply that you didn't, but this is the approach I'm going to take with this. So with respect to fossil fuels generate carbon dioxide when we burn them, there's the main three: coal, oil, natural gas. We've been getting them for a long time. We mine for coal, which that doesn't look so bad, but to be fair, there's a lot of awful mining out there. Mountaintop removal, which I just find is an awful scourge of the planet. And of course, right here in our own country, the Alberta oil sands, which used to look like this, but now look like this. And I put that there, even though this is called the oil sands, it's actually more coal than oil. Bitumen is one of the types of coal. There's lignite and bitumen and then anthracite. But they're called oil sands just because they're kind of meshed with the rock. But it's more of a coal than an oil. Drilling is a little bit better on the planet surface in the sense that you're not destroying a whole bunch of atmosphere or environment when you're drilling on, say, the Saudi Arabian desert. But of course, those sources are now being kind of diminished. We're kind of past peak oil there. So now they have to do all this offshore oil drilling. You only have to look to the BP disaster in the Gulf of Mexico to realize that offshore oil drilling does a lot of damage too. Natural gas comes from drilling as well. In fact, originally natural gas was this funny byproduct they just burned off because they didn't want it, because they just wanted oil. Then they realized, oh, we can make money off this too. So about 25 years later, after drilling for oil came along, they started to use the natural gas. So a little bit of chemistry. I got to take you through this because I think this is important to understand. Coal is essentially just carbon. There's a few other little elements in there like sulfur and nitrogen and stuff. But by and large, coal is carbon. Whereas natural gas is carbon with four hydrogens. Carbon has four bonds. And so if these bonds are attached to four hydrogens, you've got natural gas, also known as methane, also known as CH4. And that's the simplest hydrocarbon you can get. A hydrocarbon is just hydrogen and carbon put together. Now, you can change one of those bonds and add another carbon to it. And then, of course, if you add hydrogen atoms to that, you've got a longer hydrocarbon. In this case, two carbons, not just one. And this can go on and on ad infinitum. So there's methane. There's the two-carbon one I just showed, which is known as ethane. Not a lot of people know about it. Three carbons, that happens to be propane. Thank goodness we got it for our barbecues in the summer. And four carbons together is butane, which has kept the Zippo lighter company in business for a long time. And as these molecules get longer and longer, they create various different hydrocarbons. Octane is eight of them. Octopus, makes sense? Now, when we burn our fossil fuels, combustion generally takes place in the presence of oxygen. And oxygen is O2. When I've got patients who are struggling to breathe, I put O2 on them in the hospital. We're going to burn one carbon and two oxygen atoms in a molecule. We break the bonds and we put them back together, and lo and behold, we have CO2. It takes energy to break a bond, but you get energy out of reforming a bond. And the whole point is you want to get more energy out than it took to break them in the first place. Think of it this way. It takes a little bit of energy to start a fire, say with a match, when you're doing a bonfire. But as long as you've got good fuel there and you keep adding that, you'll get more and more energy than you ever invested in just that one little match. So we get more energy out of forming CO2 than it took to break the bonds in the first place by burning them. So burning coal generates carbon dioxide, straightforward. Now let's take that methane molecule, which remember was CH4. We got four hydrogen atoms thrown in there. So it turns out it's going to be two oxygen molecules thrown in. To combust those, we break those bonds, we put them back together. We still get one carbon dioxide molecule, but we get two water molecules, H2O. Even people who don't know chemistry tend to know H2O is water. The reason natural gas is the cleanest of the fossil fuels is because you're getting a lot of energy out of the bonds that you're forming from water. And water isn't so bad to create. You're still getting one carbon dioxide, but you're getting two water molecules. Whereas coal is the dirtiest because all you generate is carbon dioxide. Those other hydrocarbons, like octane, which is in our gasoline, the longer the chains are of carbon in our hydrocarbons, the less we get 2-to-1, more closer to 1-to-1 ratios for carbon dioxide to water. So they're still better than coal, but they're not as good as natural gas. And this is just kind of how we summarize it. Coal is C, natural gas is CH4, and oil, petroleum, what they're drilling for, is longer chains of carbon, 2 hydrogens added to each carbon atom, and then you got 2-1 extra at the end. That's how you make the long molecule. So if you want to know, for example, paraffin wax has 25 carbons, that's easy to say then it's C25H52, because it's double the 25 plus the 2 at the end. That's, and so octane would be C8H18. It's just easy to do the math there. So fact number one, burning fossil fuels generates carbon dioxide. No one can dispute it. Fact number two, it's a greenhouse gas. We have lots of different gases in our atmosphere. In fact, about 99% of them are nitrogen and oxygen. Nitrogen, very inert, hardly does anything in our atmosphere. Oxygen, about 21%. We've evolved to breathe in 21% of oxygen, and that's what's in our room air. If my patients are struggling, I'll give them a bit more, maybe 24% or 28%. And then some of the things that are down a little lower, anywhere from 0 to 4% water vapor, depending on where you are on the planet, about 0.4% is average. Argon is extremely inert. Carbon dioxide, 0.04%. If you want to be precise, at this moment, 0.0392%. And methane is about 1,750 parts per million, very small amount. Now, we call them greenhouse gases because everybody knows what a greenhouse does. A greenhouse allows us to grow all sorts of plants we couldn't normally do year-round during the winter or in certain climates like ours where we might want to grow something tropical. The whole point is that the sunlight comes in, gets absorbed by whatever's in there. Let's just pretend they're all green plants in there. So the green is reflected back. All the other colors from sunlight are absorbed into the plants and everything else that's in there. And then they re-radiate some of that energy back in the infrared. Generally, that means heat. The funny thing about glass is glass lets the visible light in, but it tends to bounce infrared back. And that's why it's warmer in a greenhouse. That's why it's super hot in the summer when you come into your car, the windows, you know, have been closed, and it's very hot in the car compared to even outside. So that's how a greenhouse works, and greenhouse gases are exactly the same thing. The sunlight comes through our atmosphere, and these greenhouse molecules, of which carbon dioxide is a biggie, they don't affect anything from the visible light. They don't absorb it. They just let it transmit through. And then we've got all these colors on our planet, blue for our water, yellows and browns for deserts, green for vegetation. And so those are the colors that are being reflected back, and the rest is absorbed and re-radiates that energy back as infrared, which means heat. And those greenhouse gas molecules, they tend to absorb that energy in infrared. They start moving, and of course they bump into other molecules like oxygen and nitrogen that are nearby. They get them moving, and essentially more movement means higher temperatures. We have a whole bunch of greenhouse gases. You know, and as I mentioned, oxygen and nitrogen make about 99% of our atmosphere, and they're not greenhouse gases. Greenhouse gases tend to be bigger molecules, usually that have more than one atom in them. So that's why water vapor, which is H2O, because if it's not vapor, it's not in the atmosphere. That's why it has to be vapor. Carbon dioxide, methane, CH4, nitrous oxide, which is NO2, laughing gas, ozone, which is O3, and then these chlorofluorocarbons, which used to be in aerosols and were damaging the ozone layer. These are all the greenhouse gases that we have in our atmosphere. They have a physical property where they will absorb infrared radiation and start to have more energy. And of course, anything they come in contact with will also get absorbing that energy. So carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas. Carbon dioxide levels are increasing. This is fact number three. There's a lot of carbon in our planet. Long before we were ever around, there was tons of it. In fact, so many tons that I have to put these numbers in gigatons. A gigaton is a billion tons. So in the rocks on our planet, in our Earth's crust, is about 65 billion gigatons of carbon, which means 65 with 15 zeros. There's a lot of tons of carbon in here. But you can see that it's spread elsewhere in the planet too, through the oceans, in our soils, in our atmosphere, about 750 gigatons, 750 billion tons of carbon in our atmosphere, generally in carbon dioxide. And in land plants, we've got lots. But there's been a general balance back and forth over the many hundreds of thousands, if not millions of years, on our planet. Carbon dioxide gets absorbed in certain areas out of the atmosphere and then gets released in our atmosphere. But
things changed with something called the Industrial Revolution about 200 years ago. James Watt managed to modify the steam engine so that it became much more efficient. And actually, a big thing he did was he made this rotary motion, so it wasn't just up and down and back and forth, but it could be rotary and turn things. And so all of a sudden, textiles, paper mills, everything changed. And in a short time span, England started to look like that. Factories just went up everywhere because James Watt's steam engine managed to generate a lot of energy. They used coal to power the steam engine so that it could do its job. Of course, you adapt that to something like a locomotive, and all of a sudden, you've got transportation everywhere. Places that took forever to go by horsepower, you can get to very quickly, very easily. And then, of course, nowadays, our factories look awful like this. In 2009, I happened to have a trip to Asia. That's a picture I took in Beijing. And that's honestly what it looked like the entire time I was there. I did not see blue sky the entire time. They had blue sky for the Olympics because they turned off a lot of their factories so that the planet didn't think it was awful like this all the time. But it was. It is really bad. Now, so the Industrial Revolution starts here, and all of a sudden, lo and behold, look, those top three sources of energy in our planet are the big three fossil fuels: coal, natural gas, and oil or petroleum products. Nuclear power is fourth on the planet now, and it's a distant fourth. And then, of course, some places like here where we happen to live in Canada, we have access to hydroelectric power. Not everybody does. But we're not just putting carbon dioxide into our atmosphere because of burning fossil fuels. We do other things that do it too. Deforestation and agriculture are huge. Deforestation, sure, lots of people see clear cutting, like Barrie's always getting bigger, so there's lots of clear cutting going on. But in the planet, most places when they want to get rid of a lot of forest, they just burn it. And all that carbon that is in the biosphere in the forests is immediately released and put into the atmosphere. So burning all of these forests puts a lot of CO2. And you can see what's happened. I mean, we're not talking small amounts of forests, we're talking huge amounts. This is how many square miles. You can see here in the mid-90s, about 11,000 square miles of Brazilian Amazon forest was destroyed just simply by burning. When you look at things like agriculture and livestock, that also generates CO2 emissions. When you have to prepare fields like that to grow food for people, you have to perhaps clear some trees away. You also have to till the soil, and there's bacteria that are dormant in the soil. As soon as you till that, those bacteria are up at the surface, they can start degrading and decomposing and producing carbon dioxide. And then, of course, livestock. We feed a lot of people, clothe some people too, from cattle and sheep and things like that. And cattle and sheep, they're ruminants. That means they got four stomachs. They can't digest cellulose on their own. They have bacteria.